Lion is brought to you by our stable of sponsors.
My patience is waning, is this entertaining? My patience is waning, is this entertaining?
There we go, over on the outside, putting the head just in front, and that is the first street of Stephen Marsh here in Trentham. Ballon Rouge starting to hit top gear. It is Ballon Rouge in front, Ballon Rouge. Ladies man over on the outside driving, gets it. Front Duncan Creek is roaring home down the outside, coming after Cognito, who got the front. Cognito, and Cognito will beat Duncan Creek. Lavonde Babylon Berlin won't lay down, she's fighting hard. Lavonde's fighting hard too, heads up, heads down, she wanted it. She's a great mare, Lavonde.
Was Group 1 racing at its brilliant best. A very warm welcome to Weigh In on your Monday morning. And of course, we enjoyed the Group 1 Telegraph from Trentham on Saturday, and it was taken out by Star Mare Levante. Well, Michael Guerin is out of the office, and therefore we say a very warm welcome to Paul Wilcox. Paul, great to have you on the show. And as you mentioned, what is going to be a big week for the team there at Ellerslie and, of course, Pukekohe.
Thanks, Emily. Good to be here, but Nerves on the way. Obviously, this is a massive week for us and New Zealand Bloodstock and a lot of people with particularly the two-year-old and three-year-old races for New Zealand Bloodstock. So looking forward to it, but I'll be happier on Sunday morning.
I bet you will. Well, first part of the show, we're going to be reviewing Group 1 racing from Trentham. And then in the latter part of the show, we'll pick Paul's brain with regards to what we can expect for the Karaka Million this coming weekend. Well, with that in mind, let's get to our first review of the show. And it is, of course, the Group 1 Telegraph taken out by Levante.
Pushes us through it, and she's starting to come out, and after Babylon Berlin, who joined Packing Rockstar and Levante, she's starting to come out after Babylon Berlin. Babylon Berlin, Levante over on the outside, starting to flatten out now. Levante, Babylon Berlin won't lay down, she's fighting hard. Levante's fighting hard too, heads up, heads down, she wanted it. She's a great mare, Levante, back to back in the Telegraph. It's Babylon Berlin, maybe if in doubt, get out.
Beautifully called by Tony Lee and sums it up to perfection. She is a great mare, Levante, stretches out to victory in the Group 1 Telegraph. Well, we welcome in Ken Kelso on the phone. We don't really need an excuse to talk to Ken, but great to have you on the show, Ken. And Levante, she was at her brilliant best, wasn't she, on Saturday with that dashing win. She doesn't mind sort of giving you the heart palpitations, does she? She really let it go right to the wire.
Yeah, morning, Emily and Paul. She does. She just tries her heart out every time, and record's quite exceptional. 18-19 starts and 11 wins. She's only finished further back than fourth once, and that's when she bombed the start by about 6 lengths at Tarapa that day.
Ken, that was sort of a resounding feature through the interviews you did on Saturday, was how hard she tries, and she just gives her all, doesn't she?
Yeah, she does. She just puts that head down and sort of and gets lower to the ground and just really tries. Yeah, she's certainly a tryer. Wouldn't mind a few more like her, Emily.
Ken, it's Paul here. Congratulations yet
Thanks,
again.
Paul.
From my perspective, probably the human side of things, it was quite emotional for me to see Bev there to watch Levante win. What was it like for you having Bev on side to see Levante?
Oh, it was tremendous. Yeah, it was a great day. I mean, Bev doesn't get to the races that often nowadays. And it was a big thrill that she made the effort to come down. We flew down Saturday morning and got out to the course, and we had to stay the night Saturday night. So it was, it was a great weekend, Paul.
Ken, I guess the most important question is, how's the mare pulled up? I guess she's a bit of a seasoned professional now with these trips heading down to Trentham.
Yeah, she ate up that night. And a girl rang us on Texas on Saturday morning, and she left. She'd eaten up that night, and she got home back here to Matter. Always leaving the night down there. I think it's a bit trip home that night. She got home about 12:30 Sunday afternoon, and straight in the paddock and singing out for a feed. So, and she licked the bowl clean last night, but we're fortunate got paddocks too. So she went out in the paddock as soon as she got home, and she had a night out last night. Beautiful night here in Matamata, thank God. And she got a night out in the paddock, and she licked the bowl clean again today. So last night. So no, she's fine. She's singing out for a breakfast this morning.
Ken, I guess with that Group 1 win now under the belt for this season, what comes next? You mentioned the BCD Group Sprint. Is that sort of the natural step for her?
Yeah, it is really, Emily. I mean, Fortuna Ryan sort of indicated on Saturday, oh, I don't know about going 1,200 again. She's crying out for more ground. So, you know, logical step is to go to the BCD Sprint in a month. Maybe have an option of having a quiet trial somewhere in between. It's a month between the runs. So, yeah, that's probably where we'll head at this stage.
Ken, are you having any more thoughts of taking her back over to Australia and giving her a shot again against those good Australian sprinters?
Yeah, well, of course, it's on the back of our minds, Paul. You know, once we get through the BCD, then we'll sort of work out what we do, whether or not it'll be the new market or not or something else. But yes, remembering she has actually won a mile, so it might open up a few other options. But yeah, we'll just, you know, make believe in taking one race at a time. We'll get through the BCD sprint at this stage, and then we'll sort of sit down and decide what we do after that.
Ken, you can't really take your foot off the pedal, can you? Because, of course, this coming weekend you've got Legato lining up in the three-year-old Karaka Million. Now, she enjoyed a track gallop, didn't she, on Friday? Tell us your thoughts on that.
Yeah, she had a track gallop with Wild Knight in opposition on Friday at Tauranga. Heavy clean track, a minute 47.35, I think. And that was nice work. Ryan was pleased with the work. She's pretty laid-back track worker. She only does what she has to. So I thought it was good work, and Ryan was pleased with the work. So she's progressed well since the 8 carat, and we're happy with her at the stage going into next Saturday.
You mentioned there that the track, obviously, at Tauranga was on the sort of heavier side. She's going to be better on top of the ground, isn't she?
Oh, I definitely think so. She's won on a heavy clean at Matamata as a two-year-old, but I think it's probably just a bit too good for them and sort of passed what it is. I think she's definitely proved that she's, you know, she doesn't need wet ground. So, you know, nice track around the 4, 5 or 6 would suit us ideally.
Ken, with the race coming up with Legato on Saturday, what are your plans on how Ryan will ride her?
Haven't discussed that with him yet, Paul.
Or you probably don't want to tell the other opposition either at the minute, do you, Ken?
No, that's all right. But no, we'll wait till the field comes out and then we'll sit down and have a bit of a chat. But you don't sort of change horses' patterns of racing. She obviously gets back a bit in the races. We won't be pushing the button and trying to go forward too much. But no, we'll wait till the field comes out and then we'll sort of have a bit of a think about it in the chat and see how the track comes up. And, you know, then you got the bias on the day and all those sort of things. So it's a bit early to be sort of making tactics at this stage.
Well, Ken, hopefully you can keep the ball rolling after this weekend and Group 1 success. A big well done for the win with Levante, and best of luck heading towards the Karaka Million on Saturday with Legato.
Beauty. Thanks, Emily. Thanks for the call.
Great stuff to catch up with Ken Paul. And Levante, I know Tony said it in his call, what a great mare she is, but she really is. She's so much quality, hasn't she? And she shows that every time.
100%. And we've seen that when she's raced in Australia, and it's interesting that Ken's not shying away of sending her over there again, because she performed extremely well. When you look at their very first race with which Rockin' Horse won, if she'd been on Rockin' Horse's side, potentially could have been a lot closer, but she is no disgrace coming forth, and it's great for the New Zealand industry that our sprinters are going over there and performing so well.
Yeah, exactly right, and best of luck to the Kelso team as they head forward with their future assignments. Let's get you along to our next replay, and this one, of course, is Cognito, who took out the Wellington Guineas in dashing fashion.
And the Guineas here in Academy Award upsides with the Racketeer, the inside. Now we've got coming after these is going to be on the outside, Romancing the Moon. Perfect push still there. Peppy Hard, Duncan Creek starting to run on over on the outside. Academy Awards in front. Duncan Creek is roaring home down the outside. Coming after Cognito, he got the front. Cognito, and Cognito will beat Duncan Creek. Missy Moolah.
Mark, you've been holding your breath. You were four back the fence, wanting those runs. How are you feeling in the running?
Well, when you got Opie on, he can do sort of miracle things. But no, it was a great ride, and we just had that little bit of a hiccup with the horse. He missed his run at Taupo, so you know, full credit to the horse as well, and all the team. You know, it's a tough time of the year. We're day in, day out this time of the year, so everyone's been working so hard, and to get results like this, it's fantastic.
It's a really good comeback. He showed a little bit in the spring. He looks as though he's an improved horse now, Mark. Is that fair?
Yeah, he's probably furnished up, and we love taking horses to Riccarton because the horses just grow up mentally down there, and I think the trip away just made him. And Dave bought this bloke at the Gold Coast, and he was there last week. So anyone wants to join the team, there's some shares there on the website.
What's next for Cognito?
It's a bit of a tricky one, actually. I just got to have a good think about that over the weekend and see how it pulls up. But he does hold a nomination for the Derby, but I just need a few days to have a think about it.
The beauty is these days you do have the choice. You've got Levin Classic as a backup because obviously he might even be a 1600 metre horse the way he sprinted at the end.
Yeah, he's going to keep getting better year in, year out because he's very sound and he's lightly raced, so he's got a good future.
Congratulations, Mark.
Thank you.
Opie gave us a lovely push for this horse. You were four back the fence, I think, just waiting and biding your time, just hoping the gaps were coming, but he seemed to be travelling well. Just tell us how the race panned out for you.
Yeah, I actually got a beautiful run from the gate on the fence, and I was cruising along, and from about the 600, I was really sweating on the gaps opening up, and it seemed to open up at the right time, luckily for us.
One thing, when those gates open, you still need the horse. He looks as though a horse who really could capitalise. What did he show you today?
Yeah, he's a very good horse. I haven't had a lot to do with him, but I've been riding him in a few gallops of late, and he's really given me a nice feel. So he's still learning, but he's a very, very good horse.
Mark's saying he's really growing up from the Riccarton preparation. He's not too sure about Derby or Living Classic. If you were going to advise him on today's run, what would you be saying?
I'd say Living Classic. He'll eat up the mile, so I think he's had more of that type of horse.
Yeah, good stuff. And, of course, Cognito heading towards Living Classic. Already got the, potentially, I guess, with the connections, not quite decided on what they're going to do, but already has the run under the belt to Trentham. And, geez, it was an impressive run, wasn't it? Because he still, even though the gaps appeared late, he still had to have the acceleration to go through them.
And you can't say this, but it was an impressive ride from Opie as well, and I'm sure Noel Harris will be showing his apprentice what to do because he was so patient. And again, when you're watching this, or particularly head on, I think Opie was very grateful for that Marsh horse just to move back into the inside rail, and it opened up. And yeah, as they say, obviously you've got to have the right horse, but again, give them peach of a ride. And when you can ride them like that, it doesn't use up all their energy. And I swear that, you know, the winning of a race, good horse, but you've got the good jockey on board, and Opie's proven yet again why he's so good.
So now I suppose they've got their two options, haven't they? They can head down a Derby path or go to the Levin Classic. Interesting to see what they decide to do in the coming weeks, and I guess how this horse comes through the race. But it's quite easy to forget what he was able to achieve early on in that three-year-old season, wasn't it? Because he was one of the hot contenders for the Guineas.
Indeed, and I think probably Mark will be listening to what Opie said then, because The jockeys are on them all the time, and for Opie to sort of spruik that the Levin Classic, and he didn't even hesitate saying that. So, look, he'd be wonderful to have in the Derby, but, look, the Levin Classic's really that field there is something pretty special. So take a good horse to win, but Legato's there, but after Cognito's run, absolutely he's got every chance.
So a number of these runners, as we look at the Living Classic, obviously heading towards the Karaka Million this weekend. Legato, one of those. Prowess, of course. Sharp and Smart, interesting there. Sharp and Smart obviously missing that run in the Wellington Guineas due to a stone bruise. So they're going to have to adjust their plans as such to accommodate for missing that fresh run. And here's a look at the New Zealand Derby market. Sharp and Smart at the top, understandably, off a spring champion victory in Australia over the 2,000 metres and such an impressive run in the VRC Derby. You've got Legato in that New Zealand Derby mix, as well as Cognito, who was at 26s, now into 10s, Prowess Pier, a horse who we haven't seen since the Guineas. So it's a vintage three-year-old crop, isn't it? There is so much depth, so much substance that it's going to make for a very exciting next couple of months with that three-year-old Karaka Million, the real upcoming assignment that's next.
Indeed it is, and look, I think you'd struggle to find anyone that would disagree that it's a vintage crop of three-year-olds, and isn't that wonderful for our industry? But also in the autumn when they can go over to Australia as well, because I think out of those horses there, you could probably look at five, six of them that on paper would be able to perform over in Australia. But that Derby field, my goodness, that's looking good. It'll be disappointing it's not at Auckland, but hey, look, the wonderful team at Waikato are looking after it for us, and it'd be only too good to get a really solid field like that for the Derby.
Yeah, certainly looms is a very exciting race. Well, let's get along to the Stayers, speaking of the Derby, because they were out in force at Trentham as well. Ladies' Man coming out the best in the Trentham Stakes.
50 metres, still six lengths in front from the mare. Waisaki starting to put in now, and it's Stablemate, Ladies' Man. Cup favourite starting to charge after them now. It is Segundo in front, Ladies' Man, and Waisaki put in into the middle. It is still Segundo. Ladies' Man over on the outside driving. Gets it. Ladies' Man gets Segundo. Waisaki Campionessa.
Continues a very good record in the race for you. She had to do it the hard way, Ladies' Man, but she did it really nicely. Your assessment?
Yeah, I'm not 100 with him yet. Like, he's in the cup and he's a big chance to win it. He's favourite, you know. But I think I can improve the horse. He's had a rough week. A few things have gone wrong with him, so that was a good run.
And not only the good run, the race with Saki was a really encouraging cup trial as well.
Massive. He's never raced that handy, but you put old magic hands on and he travelled beautiful, mate. And he'll improve too. So, you know, one gets the 2 miles, but the other one's bred to get 2 miles.
Yeah, and what about South Row from earlier? What was your thoughts there?
Jake, if he revisited it, wasn't a great ride, but he's a good lightweight chance too. He will get 2 miles. So we're in with a strong hand.
There's one man who loves winning a Wellington Cup, it's Craig Grills. You put your hand right up with this bloke. What did he show you today?
Yeah, that was really good. You know, he's obviously on the quick backup from last week, and last week he said to Alan he was quite keen and sort of hung on a bit. Today he was having that run, you know, he's switched off really good and showed a wicked turn of foot at the finish.
How did it help with Segundo being out in front like that? Was it giving you something to chase?
I think so, it definitely did. He's a pretty genuine horse as it is anyway, but also I think this week has, compared to last week on the better ground too, he's actually really pinged off it really good too. So now I'm very happy to secure the ride for the cup, that's for sure.
Well, you won this race last year on Waisaki, then won the Wellington Cup. Can you do the double again this year?
Oh, hopefully. I think I'm on a nice chance to do it anyway, yeah.
Okay, well done, Craig.
Thank you.
Craig Grills riding in sensational form at the moment and takes out that one of the feature races on the card from Trentham in the of Trentham Stakes. And love the way Ladies' Man got to the line. So easy and effortless, and even through the line, really showed a great turn of foot.
Indeed, an unreal finish there. And I think you can look at all three of those horses, particularly Waisaki. I thought that was pretty special with the magic hands. Obviously, Sean on Segundo thought he had it, but look, it takes a good horse to plough back that lead, and Ladies' Man did. But another Z horse, which and look, anything with Alan Sherrick going into the Wellington Cup, you can't go against them. But Waisaki there was fantastic and was only just pipped into third, so still a favourite of mine. So watch out, but Craig Grills, Ladies' Man. perfect.
Yeah, it was perfect. And we can have a little look at that Wellington Cup market. Obviously, a number of the contenders coming through the Trentham Stakes. Understandably, ladies' man, sixes into 260. We saw Waisaki in the Trentham Stakes settling that little bit closer. 18s into 350. Dionysus, another really promising stayer on the rise. 21s to 450. So plenty still to fall into place when it comes to that Wellington Cup market. And scary to think what we heard from Alan Sherrick, that some of these horses still have improvements, still screws to be turned to tighten them up when it heads towards, say, Wellington Cup. And Alan Sherrick is most definitely the man for the job. Well, with that feature race behind us, we move on to the anniversary handicap. Ballon Rouge was the winner of this one in good fashion, taking out the fifth.
Up in the centre of the course, Puncher is looking for an out here. Conor O'Kieran maybe from Providence provides Funtonic one off and podium over on the inside, and now we've got Ballon Rouge starting to hit top here, and Ballon Rouge all wide out is flying home. It is Ballon Rouge in front, and Ballon Rouge from a close thing, either bell of the ball or...
Yeah, and a really nice win from Ballon Rouge. The writing was on the wall last time out with such a good run for second. It would have given you confidence coming here today, Mark.
Yeah, definitely, Aidan, and it's good to see her back to her spring form. It's just all those wet tracks, and now she's back on good ground. She's shown what she's made of again, and she's always been a special filly because she was bred on the farm as well.
Yeah, absolutely, and an Oaks winner returning to her track. What expectations did you come here with her today?
Well, I thought as long as she could jump out a little bit better. Great rider Deans, he rode her for a bit of luck and it opened up really well for him. So, and the second mare ran very, very good as well.
Yeah, and unfortunately for her, I guess you just have to cover a little bit more ground. That was the undoing.
Yeah, well, one got the dream run through and the other one made a run down the outside. So that's racing, yeah.
Yeah, where to now for Ballon Rouge?
We'll just get her home and just reassess a little bit. Still at a reasonable place in the handicap, so we'll just regroup and have a look.
Do you get her back up in trip, or what is her trip these days?
I would think anywhere from 14 through to 2,000, I would think.
Okay, congratulations, mate.
Cheers.
Nice to get that win in New Zealand, and boy, she really showed you plenty. What about today? What did you make of that?
Definitely coming, you know, a real long way since her last. Since her last run there at Tirapa. So, look, really happy with the way she went about her business. Look, I said to the owners and to Mark, I'd like to get her out of the gates. I got her out of the gates, but she just doesn't have that natural early speed. So, I just let her be comfortable where she was and just travel in the run. They went pretty slow, so had to ride her for luck in the end. Wasn't going to be able to come around. I just had nowhere to go. So, look, it was a bit sticky for probably half a furlong, but look, it all opened up pretty quickly. So, onwards and upwards with her, I guess. You know, she done the job quite easily towards the end, so, and probably a really good effort to win from back where you were, and even watching that last, you know, that last race, the 2000 metre race, the winner come from well back, so I was hopeful that, you know, that racing pattern would hold on through the day.
Is that your first New Zealand run?
My first New Zealand winner, yeah, definitely. As I said to Lennon Rose on the, you know, a couple of days ago, I rode here 2007, 2008 just for one meeting. It was a coming for this day, actually. We didn't have any joy, but obviously I rode there last meeting at down at Hamilton there. It was a good experience. Good to tick off a winner, though.
Yeah, awesome stuff. Well done to Dean Yendel, and great to see him on New Zealand shores, and no doubt taking home the anniversary handicap, a highlight of the day. It's awesome to see these Australian jockeys coming back over. It's kind of the aftermath of COVID, isn't it? And we also, of course, have more coming in the week building up to the Karaka Million.
I think it's fantastic, and look, the more we get those Australian jockeys exposed to our racing, and particularly on our horses and winning, it's only going to encourage more to come over, and it's fantastic to see them doing so well. Look, our jockey ranks, no two ways about it, have been depleted, but with Craig Zaki and Warren Kennedy and the two South African apprentices that haven't started, Joe Doyle and the rest of the jockeys that we're having now.
It is
wonderful. And a couple of things out of this race, probably, look, I know Te Ako will get a lot of grief sometimes because they're winning all the races and people say they're buying the horses. But for me, this is a horse that David and Karen and Mark bred. Mm. So home bred, I think that would be just the icing on the cake for Te Ako Racing, because Look, they've put their money where their mouth is. They've got their own mares and they're breeding from them and they're picking winners. And obviously, as we were chatting before, Mark II fastest to 100 trainers, mm-hmm. or 100 wins, sorry, first trainer ever, taking over the mantle from Jamie. You know, that's just wonderful to see. I don't care who it is, that's a pretty special achievement. And particularly with Jamie going, a lot of people were saying, oh, you know, how good he was, and no two ways about it. Jamie was an exceptional trainer, but Mark Walker's no mug. He's won a few premierships, and look, he does a good job. He's a thinker like Jamie. It's a wonderful organisation, and it's good to see Mark getting the success he deserves.
Yeah, absolutely, and great to see Ballon Rouge back in the winner's enclosure and taking out that anniversary handicap. Well, there was a man on track who also had a really big day. We're going to hear from John Elstob, who's involved in both Cognito and Ballon Rouge, and no doubt was celebrating all evening after a big day at Trentham.
I would imagine, John, this has been one of a huge day at the races.
Yeah, it's a great day here on the Champagne track. Two good group ones. Group wins in a row.
You have to be excited about that. Was that your best start in the races or what?
Oh, look, I'd have to say when I won two group ones in a here at Trentham, same track with Imperatus and Ballon Rouge back in COVID days, was a pretty special day when I managed to get here. But oh, great day today with good friends and a lot of fun, mate.
Talk about your good friends. A wee side wager over here, I believe.
Yeah.
Running first or second?
Little Gilbert over here, he thought his horse might get in front of Ballon Rouge.
No chance.
Got the hundy.
This is the best 100 you made all day.
Yeah, that's the easiest one.
Don't worry about the group racing. Well done, boys. Go and enjoy.
Great to see people out at the track enjoying the fun, and a big well done to John with his success with Ballon Rouge and Cognito. And no doubt, based off what they were able to do, some more exciting days ahead. Well, let's get along to another horse who had a pretty good day on Saturday, and that was Codigo, who was really impressive, being Ardrossan's first stakes winner.
Codigo is starting to come across their heels and have a shot at them. Here it is, Rubicon crossing Sky on Fire. Codigo releasing Pinano over on the outside. Starting to get home as well. Here it is, Rubicon crossing the inside. Codigo over on the outside, putting the head just in front. And that is the first three to Stephen Marsh here at Trentham. Codigo gets it.
Stephen, three in a row. Did you come here thinking this was a chance today?
We thought we had a lovely team, and look, it's a bit more special, this horse, being by Ardrossan. And, you know, we trained Ardrossan, you know, bred by Lowe and raced by, you know, Lowe and Waikato Stud. It's pretty special. And, yeah, three on a day like this, three in a row, yeah, it is special for sure.
Yeah, he stalked them and he was really willing. Just tell us a little bit about this bloke.
Lovely horse, always been a lovely horse, unbeaten at the trials. He won, you know, he won his very first start. You know, we probably, you know, ran him a little bit sooner than we would have liked to, but it was a perfect race for him. Michael gave him the right run, and I'd say he might just need a little week in the paddock. He might be just slightly feeling those shins after today, but no, just super proud of him, lovely horse.
What can we see from him for the remainder of his two-year-old career?
Well, look, he's ticked off the black type win now, and look, he'll look, ultimately will be at the Manawatu size.
Lowell, congratulations. Pretty special when you breed one, they come out and win a two-year-old race in that manner.
It's very special, and the Morrison family of Morrison's Bush gave me the great-grandmother, so I bred the mother and the grandmother, and now him, and he's just a gorgeous boy.
Yeah, I mean, what about that? How special watching?
Oh, well, it was by the skin of our teeth, I have to say, but, you know, a win is a win, isn't it?
Absolutely.
It was wonderful.
Just tell us a little bit about the name, because we understand it's a bit about tequila.
It is. Well, needless to say, I didn't choose the name. Mark Chittick chose the name. I would have had some rather more girl names, but Codigo is apparently an incredibly fine tequila and made in Mexico, and we've been sent a gorgeous sort of country and western song about it. So we were pronouncing it Codigo, but apparently it's Codigo. So I'll have to send you all the song. It's really quite sweet.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
And just hold tight for the song, because we do have the song on the way to our next break. So if you're wondering what that is, tequila song, Codigo, we're going to have that on weigh-in very soon. More importantly, though, really special for Ardrossan to get his first stakes winner. Obviously looks like another great addition to the New Zealand stallion ranks, in the right place to get those results. And special for Stephen too, because obviously trained Ardrossan himself.
I think it's wonderful, and Dame Goddard. She's done so much for the industry and the judicial system as well. But look, the story in behind there for Waikato Stud, Adrossan's first serious horse, Stephen Marsh, as you mentioned, trained Adrossan. It's just wonderful. In the lead up to the sales, I think Mark at Waikato Stud would be pretty happy. It's one of those blue letter, red letter days that you couldn't ask for as a stud master. And that team's still together, Dame Goddard, Mark Chittick, and obviously Stephen Marsh. So to me, it's fantastic, and it's good to see good horses win. And hopefully,
love the way he got his head down on the line too. He really wanted it, didn't he?
He did. Look, we're watching that race before, and he had a look on the inside at the inside horses, and as you said, put his head down and really strove for that win, which is fantastic. And you know you've got a good horse when they really want to win, and we saw that with Leavante before. The good horses know how to win. Obviously, they've got to have good jockeys on board, but it's in the heart of the horse that really makes them good. But yeah, it's a cool story, and it's nice to see, as I mentioned about Dame Goddard, but also Waikato Stud. They do so much for the industry as well. And look, in the lead up to the sales, as a stud master, I think Mark would be pretty happy.
Yeah, speaking of the sales, Adrossan will be well represented at New Zealand Bloodstock yearling sales in just a couple of weeks' time. 7 yearlings in book one, 12 in book two, so plenty to look forward to. If you liked what you saw there on Saturday, the New Zealand Bloodstock sales are approaching. Well, we talk about the Kodigo song. We're going to leave you off to a break here on Way, and we're going to take a look at the Wakawaiti Cup, which was on the undercard at Wingatui. Enjoy this and the Kodigo tequila song that Dame Goddard was talking about.
Straighten up, leave it to me. Raced up on the outside and took the lead. Let's Bring It On comes with him. Sadler's Last sticking on. Leave It to Me wants to run around. Sadler's Last not done with yet. Let's Bring It On. Leave It to Me, the outside. Let's Bring It On. The inside, Sadler's Last. A great finish. Let's Bring It On. Got the head in front. Currently goes back to back and gets her 850th win.
Straight up all on the rocks. Dressed up or not. Make it a surprise, throw it back and close your eyes. I'm talking about Kodigo. Take it with me everywhere I go. It's tequila, baby, don't you know? A little sip and you're ready to roll. Make it down.
Today's weigh-in is brought to you by our stable of sponsors.
Well, this week's winner of You Weigh In is Michael O'Connell. Well done to you. You're getting a $100 bonus bet coming your way. And you've nominated. It's a bit of a roller coaster, so I'll read it out for you word for word because we get there eventually. Hi, Michael. This is to Michael Guerin. What a great name you have, because this is going to be won by Michael O'Connell. I would nominate you for the class and interviews you bring for the show, but I don't think that's allowed. Therefore, the ride of the day has to be that of Owen Patrick Bosnog Cognito. Besides the ride, he also tipped the horse earlier in the week on sports radio. Great ride, great tip. Oh yes, hi also to Emily. I'm just an afterthought in this, aren't I? Just an afterthought.
Well, at least he's talked
he's
about
talked
you.
About everybody.
He's talked about Opie.
I know.
He's talked about...
I'm glad he didn't nominate Michael.
He didn't talk about me,
that.
So...
Yeah, Paul, you've missed you out.
I'm scrubbing Michael O'Connell out. I'm sorry. Redraw.
Yeah.
Choose somebody else. So, bad luck, Michael.
Yeah, bad luck,
You win
Michael.
Some, you lose some.
Yeah. And if you would like to be in with a chance to win a $100 bonus bet, get in touch with us. You can see that at the bottom of the screen, all the ways to get in touch with us. Nominate your hero of the week to be in with a chance of winning a $100 bonus bet. Well, of course, last week, Weigh In took a break. We had a mid-season week off, and you might have missed some of the features coming in from around the country. Here's a little look at what you missed.
He's pulling to the outside to make his run. Bluey's chance. The growler. Here's Carmino Ricoso. All hail the Country Cup King. Raced up, got the head in front.
And Soldier Boy's through the middle with a good run. Soldier Boy got to the lead. On the inside, fighting hard is Segundo, and Ladies Man's trying to grab them the last little bit. They hit it. Soldier Boy.
He's three in front as he goes for Nugget Glory. The Buffer, three lengths clear from Bully Boy. Running on Bluey's chance, wider out from Hurricane. But it's the Buffer. And
and Kelsey Hannon. She gets her 50th victory and the Nuggets to boot.
Spender coming after them, Cruise Missile, DiMaggio, then Bitcoin. It's deviled him in front at the 100. Leads a length and a half, Cruise Missile charging now. They go to the line. Oh, gee, that's close. At the 200 metres, Believe in Magic, Dapper now lifting. Caravella's in third spot, then follow Faravello in third spot, followed then by Drifting. Believe in Magic, but Dapper on the outside, ranged up. Dapper put his bib in front, and Dapper will win the first. Put two lengths on them now for Master Brutus, looking to warm up late. Turned it up, then Hey Hey Baby, but have a look at a real class act back to race day, Maven Bell, and that's a brilliant fresh up win.
Well, some great racing that we missed during that week off. And for me, Paul, I think Kelsey Hannon's victory down in the Kamara Gold Nuggets was really special. You could see the emotion on her face after the win. And we saw some pretty good horses heading towards some feature races in the future up north, didn't we too?
Yeah, it was great, and also great to catch up with Kelsey on Sunday at Pukekohe, and she was talking to us about that win and how special it was. It was she didn't even know, and we didn't either at that time, her 50th win, which is fantastic. She's a wonderful rider, and also very emotional for her, as you would have seen in the aftermath of the Nuggets win, for one of the owners telling her that she'd win the Nuggets on the horse, and he'd been very sick, but he'd taken himself out of hospital and got along and watched the race. So pretty cool. And yeah, as we saw there, Dapper for the 2 year
olds. Adding to that Karaka Million picture. Interesting, isn't it?
And Holly and Jono, they've done it before, we know that. So very smart trainers sending the horse up there specifically to have a look. And obviously for them, it's a trial that won them some money, which is the way to do it for the owners. But no, look, it was a nice win. And up against some pretty good two-year-olds, but as they say, anything can happen on the day.
Yeah, really looking forward to that Karaka Million, and of course we'll get into a little bit more detail around that in our next segment. For now, let's have a look at the Standish Handicap coming in from Flemington. It was taken out by a former New Zealand graduate. You can see here, getting to the line impressively is Snapper.
He's a length in front. Dawn Passage looming on the outside. Umgar with the far side with Rose Quartz. Snapper still in front. They're starting to get to him, but he's a length clear. Dawn Passage, Rose Quartz diving up on the fence. Snapper in front, and he's going to go all the way. Snapper wins the Standish by a half length on the line. Rose Quartz second. Dawn Passage third. Umgar were fourth from Ocean Beyond. They were followed by Vesper.
And another really fitting win with the New Zealand Bloodstock yearling sales fast approaching, because this horse was purchased for $60,000 by Paul Moroney from the Book One sale, and takes out the Standish Handicap over the 1,200 metres. Had a pretty easy time of it in front, Paul, but began the career in New Zealand. Three starts as a two-year-old, including a placing behind Need I Say More in the Group 3 slipper. Was built on that, headed across to Mike Moroney's Australian-based stable, and it's just worked so well, doesn't it? We've seen it over the past year, that relationship, that Trans-Tasman sort of bubble that they've got that works so well, nursery for the horses here, and it delivers results, doesn't it, in Australia?
Absolutely, and I think probably a lot of people out there, any horse that Paul Moroney selects, he's been picking some absolute stunners, and he's having a great run, and obviously, as you mentioned, the Ballymore, Pam Gerard over here, obviously gets the eyes picked out when Mike and Paul decide that to go over to Australia, and none more so than Rock and Horse. But look, you've got those trainers that realise that, and we've seen that now with Andrew Forsman. He's picking up, having a satellite stable at the famous stable down in the Mornington
Peninsula. Macedon Lodge, yeah.
Fantastic stables there. And look, those horses that perform so well here then get the opportunity, they can settle and have their own little home base over there. It's better for the owners, they're not flying them over and back, they can settle in there, set them for the races that they're going for. So I think it's a marvellous thing to do, and you know, it's easier to fly a horse from here to either Sydney or Melbourne rather than floating a horse down from Sydney to Melbourne. So best of both worlds, and look, if we can go over and pick up some of their riches. I still like our horses to race here.
Yeah.
It's something as an administrator, it's important for our industry and keeping our ratings high or our patent correct. But look, if they can go over there and have a go and get the money and bring it back, then keep going, Peter Valandis.
And I think the other important thing is the races that the New Zealand horses are winning now, because that was over 1,200 metres. We saw Rockin' Horse taking out, obviously, that Champion Sprint, and also the Newmarket. It's not just come to New Zealand by a stayer. It's come to New Zealand by a horse that is a winner of all distance ranges.
I think you will struggle to get some of those Aussie boys to believe in that, but agreed.
To the New Zealand trainers' benefit, or owners' benefit.
Yeah, absolutely. Let the New Zealand trainers buy the sprinters and take them over, and they're performing well. But for me, this whole new season is just going to be so fantastic for New Zealand bloodstock and our vendors, because we've seen how much money has been spent on those proper English stayers. I still believe that they're missing a beat in our stayers. The way they're bred, the horse skill, the people involved in New Zealand and our grass is just so fantastic for setting up those horses, in particular stayers, not putting the pressure on them too early in their lives and leaving them here for late in their two-year-old season before they take them back across. It's such a discounted way of buying a proper horse, and I hope it continues. Look, you know, no two ways about it. Our vendors have been shut out of the marketplace for having a physical presence for the last 2 years. So this New Zealand bloodstock sales, I really think there's going to be some fireworks. And I hope so. I hope the breeders and the vendors are richly rewarded, because they've had a hell of a time of it. And we've seen a very strong ready-to-run sale, arguably the best in the world for that type of sale. So we've seen Magic Millions kick off and be extremely strong. I just hope it really pushes through over the next couple of weeks in New Zealand bloodstock. The vendors, the breeders get richly rewarded.
The most poignant part of the story around Snapper is actually the fact that this horse was bred by Sir Patrick and wife Lady Justine Hogan. And of course, we farewelled Sir Patrick earlier last week. And we just wanted to leave you this segment with Sir Patrick heading back to Cambridge Stud for one final time to say a very fond farewell to Sir Tristram.
Is brought to you by our stable of sponsors.
Very warm welcome back to Weigh In for our final segment of the show. You might have heard a lot throughout today about the Karaka Million, which is fast approaching, and of course the New Zealand Bloodstock yearling sales as well. Well, the New Zealand Bloodstock team was out and about and caught up with John Thompson about both of these impending things coming up soon.
Home stretch now, John. It feels like we've got through Christmas. The videos are done, or nearly done. Are they all done yet?
We've got two to do, actually.
Do you?
Yeah.
There's always those stragglers,
yeah,
aren't there?
Yeah, a couple of horses didn't quite parade properly, but and then the wet weather came, so
yes.
Now we're, you know, two to go, and then we're into photos and then parades, more parades next week, and then, of course, Karaka Millions, and then a week, the Monday, the horses all leave for Karaka. So, yeah, it's a pretty hectic few weeks, actually.
Yeah, and that build-up, that run-in to the Karaka Million, oh my goodness, Rich Hill has got a stellar lineup. You must be excited.
Yeah, well, look, the three-year-old race is just shaping up, really, as the race of the year in New Zealand, isn't it?
It really is.
And, you know, and obviously our stallions are going to hopefully play a big part. You know, we've got Prowess and Legato for Poisier. We've got Devastate for Vadimos, yes. And we've got Sacred Satino for Satino Aladdin, who's a Rich Hill graduate. So it really is going to be an exciting, exciting time for us.
Yeah, a bit of a Rich Hill showpiece in a way. And the two-year-old race, we can't forget that one either. You've got the favourite.
Yeah, well, I'm not one to count my chickens before they hatch, yes. But but no, it's great to have, you know, these horses performing at that level. And yes. Yeah, Tokyo Tycoon, he's an unbeaten going into the race. And you know, obviously out of the Tiakau barn, he'll have the Tiakau polish. So yeah, look, it really is exciting in many ways. And we actually have a half sister to Tokyo Tycoon in our Karaka draft. So you know, that could be very good if it all comes together for us.
How timely. That's brilliant. Yeah. My goodness. And so have you noticed, I mean, you've had a season. The champagne just hasn't stopped being poured, from what I can gather. And it must be so exciting. Have you seen an uptick in interest in Rich Hill and your stallions as a direct result of the results they've been getting on the racetrack?
Well, I guess, you know, years ago we were the new kids on the block, but we're not anymore. And of course, you know, we had tremendous success with Pentire over the years, you know, with Prince of Penzance winning the Melbourne Cup and those sort of things. But look, I mean, just our current stallion lineup, everything's just come together. They're all lovely horses with great race records and great pedigrees, and they're great physical types, but that doesn't guarantee success. So it has been, you know, really exciting and fulfilling for the staff, for everybody on the farm, you know, how things have come together. And you know, it's tremendous
getting those results.
Yeah,
fantastic.
Yeah, well, you're only as good as your last winner in this game at times, aren't you? So you know, most weeks we seem to have one, so that's good.
Brilliant.
And a really busy time of year for all of the studs around New Zealand as they prepare their horses for that New Zealand Bloodstock yearling sale. And a bit of excitement to come for Rich Hill Stud with a strong hand in both the Karaka Millions. Well, talking of the Karaka Million, it's now time to get into the nitty-gritty with Paul about the details of the race, I guess you could say. Paul, first of all, tell me about admission on track. People who maybe haven't, will have never experienced a Karaka Million at Pukekohe, what can they expect? Can they just turn up on the night? What are you expecting in terms of crowd and people showing up?
We don't know what to expect either. No, look, it's definitely going to be one of the bigger days that Pukekohe's seen for quite some time, and so it should be. In my mind, it's a flagship to the world of our racing. So we've got the boys and the girls doing the work on the track, and it's coming up looking real banger. And Jason and Emery and the team have done a great job. We decided when we did the merger that there was going to be no admission over, or no charge, no admission, no charge for admission over the racing season. And that's a way of enticing the community, and they've grasped it. So it's free to get in, so no cost there. There's plenty of areas around to watch racing. Majority of the hospitality has gone. Ellerslie.co.nz is the best place to go to have a look what is available, and I think it's only the lane which is down where the garage is, the motorsport garage.
Has that surprised you that the hospitality has been so well received at Pukekohe?
Has that it's gone so quick. So probably say to people, don't ring me, there's nothing available, no room at the inn. But look, it has surprised us, which is a good thing. Logistically, it is a challenge because the infrastructure isn't what it is at Ellerslie, and we all know Ellerslie's not perfect. Obviously, we've got to do work on that to bring it up to world class, but track takes priority at the minute, and obviously the stakes increases that we've got planned as well. But So we're delighted how it's been accepted, and particularly Boxing Day and not last week, but the week before on the Sunday out at Pukekohe, we had a great walk-up crowd. So, look, we're now hoping for fair weather, and if we get some good weather, we'll have a walk-up crowd that we'll be really happy with, and we can show off to all the international buyers how good our horses are, and as they say, the best horse will win.
The other important question for people at home is around the boys get paid, because they've become such a significant part of the Karaka Million night, the chants, the atmosphere that they bring. Are they going to be at Ellerslie? Is that what I understand?
Yeah, 100%. So we sat down with Luke middle to late last year and worked out, started looking at the logistics of having them all out at Pukekohe, which that was our priority, but... became pretty quickly obvious that it wasn't logistically going to work, and they're a younger generation of people, so we've got to make sure we understand, and Luke definitely does, and we do as well, that they're all about having a good time on course and then going into town. Mm. You've got about an hour odd trip back into town, and you know, when you've got a group of young guys and girls that are, you know, want to enjoy themselves, putting them on a bus and sort of saying, hey, you can't go to the toilet and what have you on the way back in, it just becomes, you know, Luke's very protective of his brand, as he should be. So we just wanted to make the best possible experience, decided that, yes, it wasn't at Ellerslie, so let's have a look at an alternative. And we discussed the idea of having them at Ellerslie, and look, they've got the ACC coming on, they're going to do everything live stream, so it will be like they're on course. Well, they'll be on course, but just
a different course.
Just a different course. So hopefully they're going to get a couple of hundred people along to Ellerslie, and then the proximity into town where they can all go in and carry on the experience in town. And look, if I get away early from Pukekohe, I'll definitely be swinging in, and hopefully Luke and the rest of the GOAT and the rest of the team do a good job in their punt club. They've, I think, over $350,000 invested. There's about 4,700 people involved. It's going to be fantastic, and I think this is just one way of exposing racing to a group of people that are really passionate about it, which is good.
We haven't got long left on the show, but there was some really important gallops this morning. There was sort of a breakfast with the stars there at Pukekohe this morning. Here's a rundown of who galloped at Pukekohe today. You can see a number of the top contenders, including Prowess, Tokyo Tycoons in there. Goes on to the next page as well, Sacred Setono. Very important here, and these gallops have been filmed by Trackside, and they'll play out throughout today as part of their coverage. You'll be able to see these horses working and get a good idea of what they went like. Paul, before we wrap up the show, have you got a two-year-old tip and a three-year-old tip for us before we call it a day here on Weigh In this morning?
I love Triboyand. Well, actually, I should say I'll wait until see what Opie chooses.
I've been checking my phone throughout the show. I've had no update.
That's good. Triboyand and Ethereal Star for the two-year-old, and then into the three-year-old, good luck. I think, look, I mean, you can go down probably to where Wessex is. I have always liked the Intimidator. Damien Lane's coming across, speaking of Australian jockeys, to ride the Intimidator. Absolutely love Sacred Setono, but Wild Knight, Legato, Prowess.
So much like mouth-watering, isn't it?
So put my neck on the line. I'm going to go for a bit of a change in things here and go Sacred Setono and the three-year-old.
Well, best of luck to you. And Paul, great to have you on the show this morning. Awesome to have you with us. It's a massive 2 weeks when it comes to New Zealand racing and, of course, the yearling sales as well. Look forward to the Karaka Million this Saturday. We'll be back with you on Monday to review all of the action.